A very good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So our next item is an evidence session with a panel of employers as part of our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. Last week, we started looking into the need for flexible and family-friendly working with a panel focusing on policy and a panel of business representatives. And today, we're going to hear from employers. I welcome to the meeting our panel, Helen Hurd, Head of Human Resources for Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Rachel Hunter, Director of Enterprise Support, also Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Heather Melville-Hume, Senior HR Manager, Independent Living Fund Scotland, and Harvey Tilley, Chief Operating Officer, also Independent Living Fund Scotland, and who are all joining us in the room. And we have Andy Wood, People Services Lead, the Wheatley Group, who is joining us remotely. So thank you all for accepting our invitation. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. We have approximately about 1 hour where we'll submit some questions to yourself. And please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Andy and members online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. And if you can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans if you wish to come in on a question. And don't feel you all have to answer every single question. If you have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's okay. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? So I'm going to invite members to ask questions in turn. And first of all, I'm going to introduce Miles. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to start with the question around challenges for businesses, because we've been hearing in terms of flexibility and potential flexibility within business, but just wanted to find out from yourselves what you believe the current challenges are for employers and how might this be impacting on efforts to provide a more fair, flexible and family-friendly working environment. So I don't know who wants to kick off on that. I start from one end, maybe with you, Rachel.
Thanks. So in terms of the feedback that we're getting from employers across the Highlands and Islands, I suppose the big challenge at the moment is actually the cost of doing business. The cost of materials, other inputs due to kind of inflationary pressures, there is significant increase in costs, and there are a kind of associated supply chain disruption as well, which is caused by the war in Ukraine. I think the other key area that's coming across is recruitment. The labour market is particularly tight in some areas, particularly construction, tourism, hospitality in the Highlands and Islands. And employers are finding it hard to get permanent staff, but also seasonal staff at this time of year. One of our recent business panel surveys also suggests that employers were concerned about their staff post-COVID, their well-being, burnout, because the amount of change that's going through they're going through at the moment. So I think there are a range of issues that are challenging employers at the moment, and it's difficult for them to focus long-term because of these immediate challenges.
Then you want to add to that as well?
I think from an employer point of view, and particularly thinking about Highlands and Islands as an employer, I think recruitment is a key thing, and being able to attract and retain talent. And I think we are quite lucky in that sense. We've done a lot of work around the type of offering that we can give our employees. But I think it is a constant challenge, and I think there's a lot more flexibility in the way that people have expectations around the kinds of work that they do, where they can do it from, the level of work that they want to do. So it's being able to respond to that, I think, is really key for us.
Yeah. Thank you.
Harvey Tilley, Independent Living Fund Scotland. So as an organisation, we're very similar to Highlands and Islands Enterprise, who have got a very flexible working posture, and we've got, we call it life-friendly working rather than family-friendly, because individuals have, every individual in our organisation has the ability to have the same equity of offer, no matter if they're single, they own pets, they have caring responsibilities. And we've got extensive policies which are in your packs that can be seen. And I think I would argue that, you know, we're certainly at the forefront of that. However, for us, I think some of the barriers you talk about, we work with over 8,000, it says 5,000 here, but say actually about 8,000 disabled people across Scotland and Northern Ireland. Certainly what we see is that the equity of offer that we can give to our staff, many who have disabled or long-term health conditions, is not the same for the individuals that we provide funding to live independently with choice, control and dignity. Often, we pay the Scottish Living Wage to all of our recipients, so they can then fund their own support and care. But obviously, the recruitment issues that we've already talked and you'll be very familiar with in health and social care is an issue. The fact that there's, you know, often there's very little money for those individuals. These are relatively, I'm not being critical, but low paid work. So, to go out and then to procure childcare alongside that. And, you know, I can take as a parent myself, when we moved up to Scotland, both myself and my wife work, our childcare for the month was over £2,000, you know, a month, because I was working in London. We had to provide, my wife had a job that took around Scotland, and so it was very expensive. And I just think that expense, cost of living, all of the things we've already talked about is a real problem. So I think for me, you know, I think we provide a very good set of support for our staff and an extensive set of policies, which we have publicised widely. But for me, there is a bit around equity of offer to certainly carers, family members and disabled people who employ PAs and PAs to provide that same level of support. And it's certainly something we'd like to explore further. I think the other thing is providing information to individuals. We work very closely with Flexibility Works and working families who are based in London. And often those people that sort of haven't got the right information easily accessible to them at the right time for that, so they can ask their employers about, you know, right to work flexibly and all of those things. And also I think there is, you know, COVID was a massive, interestingly, one of the plus sides of COVID is we're allowed to step much further forward into the flexible working space. What we're seeing is quite a lot of rhetoric and seeing reality. Certainly, if you read the wider press of companies retrenching back to pre-COVID posture, that is absolutely their right. But ultimately, the whole balance is, you know, something that fits the employee and the employer.
Thank you.
Hi, Heather Melville Hume, Independent Living Fund Scotland. Thank you for the invite today. I think just reiterating what the rest of the witnesses have said, and that's around, I guess, those that combination of affordable care, not just childcare, but also those flexible working options. And I think the only thing I would add is about that collaborative approach and ensuring that both employer and employee are able to make informed choices. So there's education and signposting. And I think that lack of information or that lack of having the right information available, I think that's really helpful to enable those conversations to happen in terms of those flexible working options available, because it's not just about a four-day week, it's not just about compressed hours, you know, life ebbs and flows, and so should flexible working options. And I feel very fortunate that we're able to do that in ILF, as I'm sure other employers do as well.
Thanks. And Andy, can I bring you in as well?
Yes, good morning, Andy Wood, People Services Lead from the Wheatley Group. I would echo, I guess, the two main points that the other witnesses have provided in terms of our challenges are the same. You know, it's how to best support our employees in the cost of living crisis. Aside from if affordable care rises, what other, you know, avenues are there to support people with sort of the regular, I guess, costs that they may have? We do a lot of work through our sort of We Benefit and our health plan, which provide employees with contributions towards dental, optical, driving lessons, etc. So sort of practical measures to help alleviate some of the other financial constraints or pressures that they may be under. Equally, we have one of our subsidiaries is Weekly Care, and I would say the recruitment challenge within that is it's not a new situation, it's an ongoing situation. I think one of the other witnesses spoke to that effect as well in relation to the, you know, it is unfortunately not the most best funded sector. And that comes to challenge, you know, comes with challenges to us as an employer to try and make that an attractive employment proposition for applicants.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Marie. Thank you.
And good morning, panel. You've touched on my first question, but I really wanted to ask, if you have workers whose job requires them to be physically present at a specific workplace, how do you support them to balance work and family life? And I'll pop it out to Helen.
We've got actually, I guess, very few of our workers that need to be in a particular location at a particular time. We've got some reception staff and we have some facilities management staff that would be the case for. But pretty much we are able to look at options for hybrid working, a whole range of flexibility locally, informally, around start and finish times. There's flexibility around quite well, I would say, resourced special leave provision for dealing with domestic situations, family commitments, as well as caring commitments. And I think the kind of organisation where we are, where we have got a number of staff that are slightly elderly in that they're kind of 45 plus, there are different types of caring issues that come into play. So I think there are a whole range of approaches that we can take that I think reflect the different positions that people can be in at different times in their career, and that whole kind of employee life cycle from when you start with an organisation, what may happen to you during that time to when you look at leaving the organisation. So it's being, I think, quite tailored and responsive and recognising that, you know, there's going to be different needs at different times and working around that.
Thank you, Helen. Anyone else want to come in?
So we have a number of employees that we have need them to go into the office in Livingston, which is a sort of essentially our central point of contact. Heather will talk about some of the provision we put in place to enable them to be flexible. But I think the reason we do that is because disabled people that we interact with, some of them are not online. They don't like that medium of communicating, and they like the hard copy, because often when they come to reviews and when they come to discussions, having the hard copy paperwork in front of them makes that discussion much more easy. So, you know, certainly through COVID, we thought about, you know, should we just not be in the office at all? But the reality is we get mail coming in and out each day, and there are mechanisms to do it. But also what we find is there's a mutual support of having colleagues in the office. But they're flexible of when they days they come in the office, and there's some flexibility, loads of flexibility around that. But for us, there's a core thing of actually having people in the office to enable ourselves to function, to support disabled people. Heather.
Yeah, I would just add to that. I think ILF, our focus has always been on that inclusive culture in terms of bringing yourself to work and that dignity and respect that we want to offer our recipients. So we do the same in terms of our staff. And it's about, we talk a lot about, you know, conversations off the table. So in terms of people's needs, as Helen was talking about, it's about ensuring that our managers feel comfortable and capable, but also that our staff feel enabled to have those open conversations and say, actually, this is what I'm looking for. And the flexibility that we offer staff in terms of life events is through our policy, and that policy isn't just a document, that's living, it's breathing, and it's about working with that individual and ensuring that, that supports the team and the service as well, just as we do with our disabled recipients, because we're all individual. So,
and we, you know, I'd just like to note, just the last thing is that though we have some of staff that are more centred around the office location, you know, 2/3 of our staff are home-based or hybrid working totally, but 100% of our staff have got flexible working. So, yeah, I think that's really of note.
Thanks for that. Anyone else want to come in before I move on?
Andy would like to come in.
Andy, yep.
We are in a position where we have quite a significant part of our workforce, due to the nature of the roles that we provide or have within the group, that are site-based or office-based, so primarily within our environmental and our care settings. So I think, again, echoing what some of the other witnesses have said, it's important, I think, to give people that are working in those roles the as much advance notice as possible in terms of when they are actually being required to work, so they can plan their, you know, external non-work activities around when they are required to be in work. So we have essentially a seven-week lead-in time in terms of actual shift patterns, etc. I think we also have quite a range of policies that allow for time off for a variety of different scenarios, carers, emergencies, dependency leave, etc. But over and above that, I think we have got a culture within our organisation that staff are able to approach managers and are very comfortable in terms of asking for time or assistance or support out with what may be stated in a policy. But the best will in the world, a policy can't can't cover every single eventuality. So we, within that, or over and above that, we have, you know, very much the culture of the staff are comfortable to approach, let's say, the managers and ask for time off or support or as and when required.
Thanks, Andy. Helen, do you have any views on the merits of piloting a 4-day working week?
I think it's something that we would be keen to see a bit more research on, and the outcome of, I think there are pilots that will be running. I mean, it's certainly something that we would look at considering, but I think it is one element of flexibility in amongst a whole range of other elements. And I think you're not going to get something that that suits everybody, and it's got to reflect the nature of your business as well. We have quite a range of flexible options where we've got a lot of staff that work compressed working, so effectively we'll perhaps work a 4-day week or a 4.5-day a fortnight. So I think there is a sort of indications that it certainly doesn't have a negative impact on productivity, and it could well be beneficial. I think there's been positive feedback from individuals that are, that have got the opportunity to do that. So I think it's taking all of that into account and being open to see what would work.
Thanks, Helen. Anyone else want to come on that?
I think the 4-day working week is a bit of a red herring, actually, for me. I don't think it's a 4-day. I don't think it's binary, saying I'm going to go from 5 to 4-day working week. I think for us, we've looked at this extensively over the last 4 or 5 years, actually. And we have put various submissions in to look at how we pilot those thoughts. For us, it's reduced hours. Essentially, you're looking at reduced hours. And for me, flexible working is working, you know, ultimately when it suits the business, but also when it suits the individual. And, you know, it may be that they take their time, those reduced hours, over a 3-day period, or they may take them over a 6-day period, because that works better for the way that their life is done. So for me, it's about not a binary 4-day working week. But I absolutely agree. You know, lots of research being done in that space. We're looking at doing a 35-hour, moving down from, at the moment, 37 hours. We, following the pay policy, we have an hour health and wellbeing, so it's essentially 36. Then we're looking at doing down to a 35-hour week. We've done lots of consultation work with staff. I think the major theme coming through from staff is we have very high workloads because, you know, we're in the fiscal environment where resources are scarce. So how do you balance this sort of almost contradiction between reducing hours and your workload is ever increasing. But I think there are efficiencies that can be drawn. And you know, ultimately, happy staff are productive staff. It's not rocket science.
Yeah. Thanks, Harvey. Heather?
Yeah, I would just like to add, as a small organisation, but hugely effective and hugely efficient in terms of what we do, since we started in 2015, we have over 100 working patterns. So for a staff of just under 70, there's 100 working patterns that have been looked at and actually worked. And that tells you what flexibility looks and feels like. And it's not just a four-day week. And it's about what suits that individual and what suits delivery. And actually, from recruitment, it's about having those conversations. So straight from advert, we talk about flexible working and we have those conversations because we want to create the best environment for that individual to deliver for us and for our disabled recipients. So it's having those conversations that's enabling other small employers to be able to do the same. I think that would be a real step change for many organisations.
Thanks, Heather. Your comments are very helpful. Anyone online, Andy? Do you want to come in before I hand back to the convener? No? Okay, back to yourself, convener. Thanks.
Just before bring in James, I just wanted to ask the panel your thoughts on, I know as a mum and having a child in childcare, some of the challenges was when you get a phone call from the nursery to say the child's not well and you have to go and pick them up. And more often than not, it's women that are having to do that. I'm just wondering, and the struggle is having to pay that time back or take annual leave. So we are, you know, disproportionately impacted by that. Can I just ask what your thoughts on that in terms of more flexibility there? And can I bring in Heather?
Yeah, thank you very much. Certainly within ILF and during COVID, it was very much that balance between caring responsibilities and work. And whilst I wasn't with ILF at the time, certainly one of the things that was shared was it's just what you can do. So you can only do what you can do and life comes first. And actually, because our staff are so committed and engaged in terms of what they do, it's not about necessarily making the time up. It's actually about just recognising that they need to balance that. And it's about the manager being able to then flex that workload. So I think you're right, in Scotland, I think sort of 42% of women, you know, are responsible. And there is that disproportionate impact. And so I think every policy or practice that we look at, we're always impact assessing it. And I think employers being able to do that and really look at that wider picture and being able to tap into advice and guidance in order to do that is essential. So, yeah.
I mean, I'll just add, I'm both working parents. My wife works away quite a lot. My job enables her to do her senior role elsewhere. So I get those calls and, you know, often have to go and pick up. But I recognise that the burden of that does fall. I go in the school playground and I'm one of, you know, increasingly there are more men there. But, you know, the vast proportion of people going up and picking children up are women. And therefore, you know, that means that they're getting called and they're, you know, the onus is on them to pick up. So I think from an ILF perspective, just to add further, is we don't request anybody makes up any time ever if they have got family emergencies. What we find with that is swings and roundabouts. We don't monitor anyone. We trust people to do their jobs and we don't monitor them in terms of their hours. And what we find with that is it may be that I do 20 hours this week, but in subsequent weeks I'll make that time up, and we've never ever had to monitor it. We've never had to enforce it. And what we found is that the return on that is, you know, loyalty, is highly productive, happy staff who are able to deal with not just children, but obviously their other caring responsibilities.
Well, thanks, that's really reassuring. So can I maybe bring in Helen, please?
Yeah, I don't think I could have kind of said it better myself, really. I think flexibility is an essential, and I think that needs to be recognised. And I think there will be immediate situations that need to be dealt with. And I think having that kind of safety net of knowing that that can be dealt with the support of your employer is really reassuring. And I think the whole thing round about a culture of give and take,
that there will be different requirements at different times, and I think you get paid back in spades really for having that type of approach, which all comes down to trust essentially. I mean, we don't monitor, we if things aren't working, it's keeping an eye on that. But the overwhelming response that we get from our staff is that they appreciate that kind of approach.
Okay, thanks, Helen. Can I now bring in Andy? I believe you want to come in.
Sure, yeah. I think what I would say from a Wheatley Group perspective, we have enshrined in our policies emergency leave, which covers exactly that, the scenario you described, where there's a child care has been withdrawn or isn't possible, or the child's ill, or unforeseen circumstances, we would provide paid leave for that. There's no requirement for the individual to pay back any time in respect of that. Also, in respect to we have 45% of our roles have as a result of COVID, the one plus side I would say out of it, have moved to home working contracts. And within that, basically the employee has the flexibility to choose when they work. So there's an inbuilt flexibility if they need to go and pick up a child from school or child, nursery, etc. That doesn't impact on that sort of contractual obligation there.
Thanks, Andy. I'm now going to bring in James and then Gordon. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Part of the question that I was just about to ask has been answered in the previous responses, but I'd like to come to you first, Andy. You've touched on it there about the sort of the great amount of homeworking you've got and the flexibility that the workers have within that. But how do you ensure that an employee, say, with the additional caring responsibilities towards a disabled child, for example, are supported further to the maybe just the flexible part of it?
Yeah, we've got a number of ways in which we support staff in that situation. We recently did a survey which I think 47% of our staff stated that they had some sort of care and responsibility, that could be for a child, an adult, a partner, whatever. So we first and foremost, we have a number of staff groups, one of which is a very active carers group, which is sponsored by a member of our executive team, comprised of colleagues across all levels of the business, to share experiences, share their support, and we have also brought in, as part of that, speakers from external organisations to signpost staff in caring responsibilities to support. They can receive grants, etc. We have internal knowledge through our own welfare benefits money advisor roles that again can be used to signpost our staff to available grant support, where they can get adaptations in the houses, etc. We also provide 6 paid days carers leave for staff. We also, where possible, we have a commitment to try and, if staff are based on site or a working location, we try and ensure that that's as close as possible to their home or the caring location, to ensure that the travel time is minimised as far as possible. We also have I think that's kind of the main supportive measures we have in place.
Well, I've got you on then, Andy. What advice would you give to other employers seeking to be more flexible and family friendly? I'll come back to the rest of the panel with that.
Yeah, I think it's really realising that what might be deemed or what we consider as flexibility for one is not flexibility for another. Everybody's got their own needs. I think you've got to ask the question. You've got to listen to the responses. I think you've got to be open to trying new approaches. There may be some flexible working or sort of requests that come up that you've not tried before. For example, in the group, we introduced term time working several years ago, which was something we had not looked at before, and it proved to be very popular. Less so now that we have moved to home working. We don't have as many requests for that term time as we previously did. But certainly that was something new for us, and was again, other witnesses have talked about the buy-in and the motivation and the
you know, you want a content workforce. And certainly we got very positive response because we listened to all, that request was put in place for following requests from staff, from feedback about what we were maybe not providing that they would that would suit their work life balances.
Thank you. Convener, does anybody else want to come in?
Heather would like to come in.
Yeah, just to add, in terms of the suite of policies that we have, but more importantly, it's not just about what's on paper, it's about that practice, and it's about enabling that. So it comes down to culture and those conversations. So I think other employers, it's about enabling those conversations and encouraging those conversations and gathering that feedback from your staff and from colleagues. And I think, you know, we do so much more and go over and above in terms of our policies, in terms of things like, you know, we've got bereavement policy, we've signed up to a bereavement charter, recognising the impact of that. We have health and monthly health and wellbeing sessions. And again, it's about having some difficult conversations around some really challenging subjects at the moment, given the financial impact. We ran a financial wellbeing seminar, and again, that was enabling and signposting people. So it's some really challenging subjects, but again, it's about signposting, because not one size fits all, but it's about enabling people to make informed choices and being able to take that time and work flexibly to go and support themselves and get that life balance.
We've used the staff survey tool as a really useful way of co-creating our suite of support for individuals. And over the years, you know, I remember a colleague who said to me, you know, I haven't got children, but I've got, you know, two pets, and they are everything to me, and that is my life. One of their pets were really poorly, and they had to take them to the vets and all of that side of things, really worried about the consequences of their work. We'd only just started ILF, and so we created a sort of a pet leave policy, so as part of our suite. And obviously we've really talked about the whole idea of allowing people sort of time off for dependents. So I think Wales is, you know, 2 or 3 weeks off for time of dependence, and then there's carers leave, and there's all of these other things. And what we find with that is, it sounds really sort of excessive, but what we find is the return on that we get is we're a highly productive public body delivering the best support for disabled people on behalf of the Scottish and Northern Ireland governments. It's, and again, for me, it's just not rocket science.
That's good to know. As a dog owner, Harvey, I'm delighted to hear that, because I know the challenges I face trying to get dog care as well. So that's a really good policy to bring in. Can I bring in Rachel?
Yeah, I mean, I think just generally, we need to promote that there are significant business benefits to family-friendly working policy. I mean, I think you've mentioned, you know, increased motivation and productivity, and we've seen that. There's been studies done by the Fraser Rallander Institute that have shown that. But I think also, you know, staff are less likely to be off ill and are happy to go the extra mile. There's reduced sickness rate. But also it's good for customers too, because I think, you know, people want to buy products and services from, you know, good employers, ethical employers, and I think it is seen to be it's enhancing brands and reputations if, you know, people, you know, if employers are looking after their staff and have a range of policies to support that staff. So I think business reputation and recognition is really important as well. It enhances that reputation and recognition. And I always think, you know, we're speaking to employers about fair work, you ask them, what do your staff say about you behind your back? Because that's what they're going to say to other prospective employees of your organisation. So I think, you know, do they say good things about you? Are you a supportive employer? And if you are, then, you know, they're going to say that to other people that you may want to recruit in the future, because we've spoken already about the challenges around recruitment. So having a good reputation as a family-friendly working employer will help recruitment in the long term.
Do you want to come in, Helen?
Yeah, yes, I think it was a question round about the kind of advice that we would give. And I think flexible working is one part of a whole approach to fair work. So, you know, having engaged employees where there's effective voice, there's opportunity, security, fulfilment, respect. I mean, it's all part of that one thing. And I think just focusing as well maybe on the role of line managers, because they are the sort of key interface between the organisation and your staff, and will influence the experience that the individuals will have. And I think, as has been said before, you can have a whole range and suite of wonderful policies, but if that's not being reflected in the discussions that take place and the support that there is from line managers, then you know, that's where it can fall down. And I think I would say as well, round about recruitment, where just being very upfront about, you know, we say that we are happy to talk flexible working in our adverts, so that there's the recognition that, you know, have that open discussion upfront at the recruitment stage, you know, build that trust. And it just makes for a better relationship going forward. So I think all of those things working together will support family-friendly, flexible working, but it needs to be a kind of holistic approach. Yeah.
Taylan. Heather, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I think don't underestimate the value of having these types of conversations and offering that flexibility. I've had a number of conversations with individuals in terms of the positive impact around their mental well-being. So it goes back to that sort of positive, content, happy workforce. And I think a number of people across the industry, but also in terms of the practitioners that I work with as well, people have turned around and said, flexible working has literally kept me employed. Do you know, it's enabled me to live a life and to, you know, support my family, whatever the makeup of that is. And I think the positive impact around mental well-being and resilience, particularly in today's climate, cannot be underestimated. And I think as a small employer, other employers looking for advice, they need to see the value in that, you know.
Okay. Thanks, Heather.
Thank you.
Sorry, James, did you want to come back in at all?
No, that's fine. That's great. Thanks very much, Pam.
Okay, so I'm going to invite Gordon to come in, and then I'll bring in Paul. Thanks.
Thanks, convener. This neatly goes into the line of question that I was talking about. We've heard about best practice, about flexibility, how it helps retain staff, etc. Also, the other aspect of that, if we're going to help parents out of poverty, is encouraging employers to pay the real living wage. But my question is around support for businesses. So how do we improve engagement with businesses to provide practical advice so that the benefits that you guys have witnessed for having flexible working, paying at least the real living wage, can be rolled out to, well, we've got, what, 85,000 small micro businesses in Scotland. You know, how do we improve that engagement and promote what you guys have just spoken about?
I mean, I don't underestimate. We're in a very fortunate position. You know, we're fully funded. We act on government policy that is forward fit thinking, and rightly so, and progressively positive, should I say. I think the challenge is that small business, and I'm not, you know, we run an efficient organisation, but, you know, we haven't got the, you know, profit and loss, we haven't got the rising energy costs, we haven't got, they're not as in front of our thinking. So paying a Scottish Living Wage. In fact, I think all of our employees get higher than the Scottish Living Wage. In fact, I'm confident all of them get higher than the Scottish Living Wage. But I don't underestimate the challenge. So you asked the question about what can we do. Yeah, I think there is advice, and I think there's a lot more advice. There is the piece that we've talked around promoting the benefits, but ultimately there is a financial issue here, and for in organisations who are already on that very that financial tightrope between you know, solvent business and insolvent business, you know, offering this nirvana of Scottish Living Wage or higher pay is sometimes very difficult. I don't know, you know, the solution, I suppose, you know, ultimately, are there some tax breaks? Are there some things that can be done from a system level or a government level that can enable people to ensure that those benefits are spread across those certainly micro and small businesses? But again, I think that is a very difficult question to try and resolve.
Yeah, you're right about being a difficult question, but I mean, surely it's about promoting the benefits. So if you pay the real living wage, you reduce your recruitment costs because you've not got staff turnover. You're also in a situation where you're not having increased training costs as well because you're retaining that member of staff.
I 100% in vehement agreement with you about that. But I think when, you know, and I've got, you know, friends who've got businesses, and what they say to me is, you know, That's all well and good. That's all well and good. But I'm, you know, kind of fighting for my financial survival of my business. Mm. And some of these things take a while to bed in. They take a longer period of time. The next thing that comes in, sort of rent rates, rising costs of materials. And I think when you're trying to... I agree, all of the things you've said make absolute business sense to me. And it would be, if I had a small business, it would be, I want to be doing that, but I just don't recognize. I recognize the challenges without being a business owner myself. I recognize the challenges of that for you know, people I know.
Rachel, then Heather.
Yeah, I mean, I think certainly in the Highlands Islands Enterprise, we've spent a lot of time looking at promoting the business benefits, and we've got various case studies of micro and small businesses right across the region, remote and rural areas. I think, you know, the real living wage, wages are rising, and, you know, as we say, we've got a tight labour market. I think you're right, and Deputy Convener, and that, you know, when we're speaking with businesses, you have to look in a longer term. Mm. You know, businesses want to retain their staff, and if they think about the additional recruitment costs of, you know, constant staff churn, because, you know, staff will just go out there and find a better job, better paid job. So that there are additional costs involved in retraining and re-advertising jobs successively. So but I think, you know, some employers do find it a challenge to keep up with the annual wage rises. I think we also need to make sure that, you know, that small businesses, that they're engaging with business intermediaries, such as banks, accountants, other advisors, trade bodies, and membership organisations. We need to make sure that these organisations understand flexible, family-friendly working policy and what the benefits are, because these are the, on a day-to-day basis, these are the people that small businesses are interacting with, and they need to be, you know, gend up in terms of what the benefits are too. So it's not just about, you know, government agencies providing, you know, case studies and so on. I think the other thing that we have done in the Highlands and Islands is we've actually got a programme of specialist HR support that we can bring in to small businesses to help them develop a Fair Work Action Plan, so to understand what the benefits will be, but also the longer term financial impact of you know, paying the real living wage and what that might mean. So I think we're trying. I know we're probably going to speak about fair work conditionality, but from a Highlands and Islands point of view, we've always had the kind of carrot approach. What are the benefits of fair work? How we can promote that and get businesses on that journey before thinking about, you know, having a stick approach around conditionality.
Okay, Rich. Heather, sorry.
Yeah, I would just add to that, recognising that a lot of small, medium, micro businesses, they don't have access to HR resources like some organisations, so they don't have those subject matter experts. So I think in terms of where you can influence and manage policy, it's about giving them access to that and recognising that maybe where they are getting that advice at the moment is under huge pressure, you know. So I know certainly in terms of some of the voluntary work that I do and that I have capacity to do because of the organisation that I work for, people are tapping into that all the time in terms of, I didn't know about that, or we can signpost that. So I think a lot of bodies and being able to promote that and support that as well, but also you know, things through like business enterprise and other agencies in terms of giving them more funding to support the small and medium to tap into that experience and that knowledge, that up-to-date knowledge, and being able to support those conversations that need to be had. Thank you.
Just on that point, we heard last week the new legislation that's coming in across the UK for day one right to flexible working. that, if I get my percentages right, 49% of businesses were unaware of it.
I know.
Is there a need for a business mentoring system to be introduced, and who would run it? Would it be the likes of Highlands and Islands?
I mean, I think, again, it's about maybe promoting across, promoting this through intermediaries, particularly in banks. And I think you've got to think about who a business is interacting with. You know, enterprise agencies probably only deal with a certain selection of a certain section of businesses in particular regions. Business Gateway and local authorities are another body that you could help promote this new policy coming in. But yeah, it is challenging for you know, very small businesses to keep up with the latest legislation, but it's just making sure that those that support small businesses are aware of this. And you know, any mentoring schemes or whatever, you know, that this obviously that could be built into that there are mentoring schemes that are run by enterprise agencies, but I think it's a bit more promoting this through the business intermediaries.
Okay. Andy, I think you want to come in then, Harvey.
Yeah, just I guess to reiterate what the other witnesses have said about the there might be small organisations that are very willing to and keen to try flexible working and maybe the added benefits to them, but it's kind of that the getting off the ground part. It's having the knowledge or the access to the support to actually do it, to understand what the legal and practical and financial implications of putting flexible working in place are. So yeah, having some sort of central body or team of advisors or something that can assist them in doing so would only be a beneficial and drive uptake of flexible working practice. And also, as you stated, that the awareness of some changes that are coming down the tracks quite soon to ensure compliance. I think, you know, it was mentioned previously as well about having, you know, testimonial or case studies of small organisations where it's worked. Maybe sort of what's and all, you know, what were the challenges, what were the kind of potholes in the road on that journey, but ultimately what are the benefits of embracing flexible working?
Okay, thanks. Harvey?
I often think about sort of practical solutions and something that can be achieved, and we work with you know, thousands of disabled people. We work through them thousands of PAs, and often I think a really practical way, and perhaps you know, the Scottish Government have done a lot in recent years to promote things like the Scottish Living Wage and to invest it, and it's investing into the health and social care environment. But I think procurement is a real issue, and I think that you know, a way of perhaps leading the way is that all tenders that go out for health and social care contracts have Fair Work at the core of that, and the funding to provide and ensure that is given over to the staff and employers of those organisations. And for those who are providing direct payments to disabled people, and we provide a quarter of all the direct payments in Scotland, you know, and we provide some provision within that to be good employers, but actually we're limited on the amount of money we can because of the wider environment we're in. But actually, you know, that is a direct way of influencing through direct payments and making sure that those disabled people have the ability to be even better employees than they already are, and use the procurement frameworks to invest and to to articulate what the requirement is from those funding bodies around things like Fair Work. I think is a really practical way, and something that could be achieved relatively quickly. I think we've got a good set of suggestions.
Just my final point and on that you've just raised, Harvey, you're right that procurement law can be brought into use to promote the real living wage and flexibility and all of that, but would it not be easier? We had a call last week from the STUC suggesting that employment law should be devolved. Would it not be easier if we had the powers to actually do something about it rather than play about with the procurement regulations?
Well,
Well, that's an interesting question, and I'm not sure quite how to answer that. I think there has been devolved legislation that has absolutely benefited Scottish citizens. I think that the problem with procurement is often looking at the lowest cost. And I think, you know, to answer your specific question, absolutely, I wouldn't disagree that for the benefit of the citizens of Scotland, if, you know, some of those issues could be devolved. I'm not a constitutional lawyer, so it's a bit hard for me to think through that. But certainly it makes sense for citizens of Scotland to have those devolved powers, to have both employment law, but also, you know, on a broad practical level, you know, let's not look for the lowest cost employer or lowest cost bid and procurement frameworks, because that's how it's all configured, ensure that Fair Work comes right through that.
Okay. Thanks very much, Camilla.
Okay, thanks. That's been helpful. I'm actually going to bring in Jeremy before I bring in Paul, because Jeremy has to leave us at 10 o'clock. So can I invite Jeremy?
Thank you and good morning, panel. Thank you so much for the evidence you've given so far. This committee is a wee bit Central Scotland based, and we are aware from previous sessions that there are those who live within rural Scotland who maybe have extra issues compared to us city slickers. So I'm just wondering if you can, particularly for working for low-income parents, transport, childcare, affordable housing, what can business and employers do to address these issues, perhaps particularly within rural areas? And maybe, Helen, I can start with you and then see where we go from there.
Yep. I think there are clearly different issues in rural areas where there isn't maybe a sort of critical mass of available services and provision. And, you know, what we hear from working parents is that childcare needs to be affordable, accessible, and there's issues round about, you know, times and location where that's provided. And I think there is so much that can be provided by private providers, but I think there probably is a case for some kind of subsidy there or support to maybe fill the gap, because trying to have a viable business providing childcare, there's a whole lot of issues that I think do come into sharper focus when you're looking at rural, more sparsely populated areas. I'm not sure, Rachel, whether...
Yeah, I think the regulations and the ratios around childcare are, I suppose, very much, I suppose, skewed towards an urban setting. And when it comes to childcare provision in rural areas, particularly in very small island areas, then you just can't get that economies of scale. Childminding is seen as a really good flexible option in very remote and rural areas. One of the challenges, though, is that it's usually a parent, usually a mother, that will set up a childminding business, and they'll have their own children. But in terms of, they don't get any payments for their own children, so it then compounds that financial burden of setting up the business. I mean, we have been working with the Scottish Childminding Association in Hyde, and we've seen about 30 new childminding organisations being set up, but across the region, but there are still pockets, particular areas in island communities where there is no provision at the moment. It is a real challenge. I think one of the big challenges for, and I'm from Shetland, so I've been through all this, is you've got to throughout the working day, you might have to move your children. So you might have to put them in a breakfast club, then you've got to get them to school, and then you've got to get them childminded after school, or vice versa. I think it's all over, and I hear lots and lots of stories of stressed out parents having to try and move the children through the working day. So I think one of the things that we really need to look at is existing infrastructure. So schools, for example, if a kid's in school, can they have, you know, a breakfast club and an after-school club, so they don't have to move them around during the working day. We're also looking at a pilot from this kind of a cradle-to-grave type pilot, where you'll get a care facility that can be used for the older people, but also for children, and you can have them one facility, because I think let's use the infrastructure that we've got a bit more creatively and wisely. And you know, the other challenge is obviously recruitment in childcare. We just don't have enough people for the ratios in the Highlands and Islands. So I think that's is a big problem in rural Scotland, and you know, keen to work with Scottish Government as we are working with parts of Scottish Government, the Islands team and so on, to look at this problem and address these issues.
Helen.
Yeah, I'll just add to that, it's not solely about childcare, it's about care in general. So it's about you know, young disabled children, it's about children and young people with additional needs, it's about care for disabled people, you know, across the country, but particularly in rural areas. So I guess that sort of using existing infrastructure is key, but also being able to ensure that that care isn't just focused on purely children.
I actually have it was interesting, as a committee at the beginning of this year we did a visit to Uist, and it was really interesting to see the distances people have to travel to be able to either have older people care or younger people care. And I suppose you were saying you are working with Scottish Government. Yes. I'm wondering, is there more Scottish Government can do to help particularly rural island communities around flexibility, around that? Maybe, I mean, I think it's very interesting, this model of everything happening in the school rather than having to move around during the day. Are there models out there, or more Scottish Government can do to support that?
Yeah, I think I think the Scottish Government can help by bringing, because it's a multifaceted issue, and you're speaking about the school estate, you're speaking about childminders, you're speaking about local authority providers. It's actually about, you know, getting people joined up in these areas to work together, and also to think it from the parents' point of view and the challenges. You might be able to find childcare from 8 till 6, but you know, you've got to move kids around during the day, or you've got to travel huge distances. So it's trying to think from the, well, you say, the customer's point of view, and I think the Scottish Government can help, you know, bring the sort of key organisations and the different parts of government together, and that going forward.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. I'm now going to bring in Paul.
Thank you very much. Convener, I suppose I just want to expand perhaps on the conversation we were having there in terms of the rural locations, and maybe ask more broadly about childcare. A lot of the conversations we've had in committee have been about the expansion of funded childcare to 1140 hours. And obviously there are discussions ongoing about how that might be widened to 1 and 2 year olds. So I wonder if the panel has a view on you know, would further state-funded childcare be beneficial? And I think, how do we ensure that flexibility? I'm not sure who might want to come into that. I mean, Rachel, you were on a roll there. I don't know.
I mean, Paul, I would just say it's, absolutely. I think having childcare from birth, you know, or from the time that the parents or the mother wants to move back into the workplace or to do other things, having affordable childcare from pretty much as day one, right, and expanding that, you know, that range, I think is absolutely, I just think it's key. I don't think, I'm in a vehement agreement, more hours, a wider range, and I think that will absolutely have a significant impact on all of the issues that this committee is trying to challenge.
I would completely vehemently agree as well. I think when you look at the return on investment that you've got there, you know, there's economic return, well-being, education, development. You know, that's really key to everything. And just looking as well at the research that's been done by Flexibility Works, and going back to almost kind of like selling the benefits of, you know, what greater flexibility and having that kind of support can achieve. And, you know, we're looking at productivity, loyalty, retention, business costs, impact on mental health, well-being, delivery, engagement, reduced sickness. You know, so that there's an abundant range of really important measures that can be influenced by having that focus. So, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think childcare is a public good, and I think we're not going to see our overall economy thrive without, you know, increasing support for childcare and see more investment in that and funded places. I think we often in Scotland, you know, compare ourselves to Scandinavian countries, and I know I have friends in Scandinavia and Norway, and, you know, they know that they're going to get childcare from 8 o'clock in the morning till 6 at night, wherever they are, and it's a daily stress that's taken away. So I think, you know, if we're modelling ourselves on that type of countries, you know, or that type of economy, then that's where we need to go.
Okay, I don't know if Andy wants to come in at all. Okay. Paul, if you get any further questions?
No, Convener, in the interest of time, I'm happy to hand back to you.
Okay. So that's us come to the end of our questions. So thank you to all our witnesses for taking part and sharing your expertise. We will continue with the inquiry in September. This is obviously our last day before we go into recess, hence why you're seeing lots of smiley faces here today. So, yeah, we're going to continue on with the theme, in particular on transport and the challenges that brings as well. So I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for the setting up of the next item of business. So thank you very much for joining us. So welcome back, and we are now going to hear from Social Security Scotland on disability benefit processing times. I welcome to the meeting David Wallace, Chief Executive at Social Security Scotland, Ali McPhail, Deputy Director for Strategy, Change, Data and Engagement at Social Security Scotland, and Sue Scotland, Deputy Director of the Social Security Programme Management and Delivery Division at the Scottish Government's Social Security Directorate. All the witnesses for this session join us in person. But before we begin, I would like to remind members online to please allow broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in Blue Jeans if you wish to come in on a question. And again, can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? I'll now begin by inviting David Wallace to make a brief opening statement. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity this morning to speak to committee and members. I won't reintroduce my colleagues, and you know, we'll be hearing from them in the questions as well, so thank you for that. I just wanted to start to say by it's just been over sort of 6 months since I last appeared in front of this committee, and I know there's a number of new committee members that have joined us as well, and we haven't yet had the opportunity to have you welcomed into the agency. I very much look forward to welcoming you to Dundee, which I think we're looking for a time in September for those members that can join us. I did want to just sort of reflect back into December. When I joined you in December, we were in the midst of extending the SORUS child payment and for people under 16. We now have over 300,000 children in receipt of the Scottish child payment, and in total we've paid over £248 million since the Scottish child payment was launched in February 2021. Since that appearance in December as well, we've also completed the first winter heating payments to almost 400,000 eligible clients in Scotland. Members will know and appreciate that Social Security is one of the largest delivery programmes and transfers of powers under devolution. By the end of 24-25, we will deliver 16.5 million payments per year to people in Scotland, worth around about £6 billion to an estimated 2 million people. We've done this by building a brand new public service from scratch, and we've introduced 13 Scottish Government benefits, 7 of which are entirely new forms of financial support available only in Scotland. And I've spoken before here about the pace of delivery, and if I use the example of Scottish Child Payment. Scottish Child Payment went from inception to its initial delivery inside 18 months. The way we do this is we work very closely with our colleagues from Scottish Government to create the new Social Security system in Scotland. Scottish Government colleagues work with ministers on the policy, processes and systems, and Social Security Scotland use these to deliver the benefits. They also work in line with the ministerial decisions on who can get paid benefits, how much people should get, and this is also a joint programme with our UK colleagues from the Department of Work and Pensions. As usual, then, I'll do the caveat that I'm happy, obviously, to answer questions, but I'm unable to really comment around about the policy behind some of the benefits. I wanted to turn to processing times, and I just want to be absolutely clear. I know some of the benefit processing times are taking far longer than are acceptable. I absolutely share the frustration around about this, and we as an organisation are absolutely committed to giving clients decisions as quickly as possible and making sure that we've got the information required to get decisions right first time. We did expect that processing benefits we'd need a little bit of time to settle in, and this is very much in line with all new benefit launches, including indeed the launch of Personal Independence Payment, PIP, when it launched back in 2013. But I do want to absolutely assure the committee we are committed to getting this right for our clients, and we are taking urgent action to address some of those, improve those processing times. So action is already underway. To reduce those times, and I believe that we can demonstrate that those actions are having an impact. So we've put in the written submission some of the work that's going on. I just want to reiterate some of that work. So we've already made changes to the application form for clients. We're drawing far more on our in-house health and social care practitioners to make early decisions based on their expertise as well. We've made a number of changes to how we handle calls so we can ensure that our clients are able to speak to us about applications. And we're reinforcing with our clients how they can help us reach timely decisions as well with supporting evidence. We are also taking a comprehensive look at every step of the journey, from people applying to benefits right through to payment, and anything that identifies that will help processing times, we will ensure that we can take. So I look forward to taking your questions, and thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, David. That was very helpful. So I'm now going to invite the first member to ask questions, and if I could just invite Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I thought it was interesting from the outset, David, that you acknowledged processing times and concerns around that. And I think our constituents are certainly saying that. I was looking at your social media feed last night, and that clearly that is where a lot of traffic and anger is. So just wondered particularly, what parts of the process currently are contributing to that long process time? And is there a difference then between ADP and CDP and how that's being managed and operated in that processing?
There's a number of things probably going on, so I'll outlay a couple of those, and I'll maybe ask colleagues just to come in as well. So, as I said in the opening statement as well, adult disability in particular is still what we would term a relatively new benefit. We're still under a year of having launched it. So everybody involved in that process has been new into the organisation. We're having new systems, we're having new processes. So what we've had probably for the last sort of 8 months or so is we've been building up as applications come into the organisation. We've had more applications coming in than decisions that we've been making, so inevitably we sort of build up what we would term ahead of work. But as you rightly say, these are clients' applications that we need to process. So we are now in a position where I think we can demonstrate that we are now processing far more that are coming in. So, you know, to use an analogy, if you think of filling up a bath with applications, we've spent 7 months filling it up, and now we're starting to really get into those applications. In terms of the differences, the main difference is obviously between child and adult disability is that on adult disability, we have the ability to do consultations around about that. But the main sort of element that I guess we're seeing initially as a bit of a blocker is that supporting information. And again, there's a bit of a difference between child and adult as to where we think we're getting our quality supporting evidence. So for children in particular, schools, we would find that are generally aware of how a condition impacts a child and are quite a rich source of information. But aside from the consultations and where we might get supporting evidence from, the both benefits are essentially in the same position.
Yeah. Thank you for that. So it's not necessarily an issue with regards to capacity then within the organisation and time to process?
I wouldn't describe it as a capacity issue at the moment. So we have, as you know from previous benefits, we sort of build up the capacity as we reach as the benefit goes live. And as benefits go live, clearly, you know, our first applications are the first time we're seeing things. So we've got people who are new into the organisation. They're also picking up a process for the first time. They're seeing a client with a particular condition for the first time. Clearly, the more experience that they build up to doing that, the quicker that becomes. So we would normally say within the organisation it probably takes about a year to get somebody from joining the organisation to being fully effective in terms of making these decisions. And clearly, you know, we're only really just hitting that period for some of our people coming in. So I would describe it at the moment as saying it's less about the overall resource of the organisation. I think it's about making sure that the resources we've got are up to capacity, up to that wider capability and able to make decisions.
Okay. Thanks for that. And have you reviewed information you're providing to clients during that period of time as well? I noticed there seemed to be a lot of people saying seven times they've been asked to review or provide information. And so on that journey, have you reviewed how people are being kept informed of where they're at or how long this is going to actually take so that expectations can be managed in that way?
So I'll maybe say something and then bring Sue in, who can say a little bit more about her role and how we're working on that. So we've certainly been looking at what information that we give to clients through the process. I mentioned in the opening statement we'd already made some changes to the application form. So the changes we've made to the application form are to really try and emphasise to people that if you have supporting evidence, please do give it to us. We recently published some research that is really the first bit of research about people who've gone through the adult disability process. And there was certainly coming through there a feeling that clients believed it would be easier for us to get information. And whilst, of course, we can collect information on behalf of clients, we still need to go to the same people to get that. So if clients have available information, then we've been trying to be clear in the application process of please give us that. The example that we kind of classically use is, for example, a prescription list. Mm-hmm. So actually, lots of clients will have a prescription list available, and if that can be shared with us early, that actually helps us make decisions. So one of the other things that we've done is to try and put a step in place that when we're looking first at an application, we're getting back in contact with that client and saying, is there anything else you've got? I know you've given us some stuff, or you've asked us to collect it, but do you have anything to hand which we think might would help that? But I'll maybe just ask Sue to reflect on the point around about informing clients.
Yes, so I work for the Scottish Government for the programme. So again, we look at the sort of the service design and then the implementation, and it's very much hand in hand with the agency. So when we delivered for ADP and CDP, we continue to work within the agency with our teams to look at and prioritise some of the activity that we were looking to deliver. So from a notifications perspective, we're looking at that end-to-end journey and revisiting that to look and see whether or not we can add in any steps, and there are definitely steps that we can put into that process, and that review is currently underway. We're also working, looking at, as David mentioned, around the applications, and also looking at how we can interact with clients at a very much an earlier stage, rather than waiting till later on in the journey, where then we're asking for information, which might seem that's the wrong order. So we are looking at that early stage interaction, but also looking at digital and you know, different ways in which we can then interact with clients on a much more regular basis as their application progresses through that service.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. Can I now bring in Gordon?
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning. I wanted to ask you about getting supporting information from third parties. So, I mean, you mentioned about schools that you clearly have to get information from health boards, local authorities, GP practices, maybe third sector organisations. I noticed there was a comment from the Scottish Commission on Social Security that said eliciting timely and detailed supporting information from busy professionals, which is focused on daily living and mobility activities, will be challenging. So I'm wondering what steps you are trying to take to smooth that process and reduce processing times by getting information more timely from these third-party organisations.
And I think I'd absolutely recognise the comment that had been made around about that as well, of being challenging. So some of that is the work that I described, outlined with Mr Briggs. If clients have got it, that's actually one of our first steps of saying, if you have this, please give it to us, and that will help us make more timely decisions. But we're also working very closely with GPs, health boards, as you described, to try and make that process easier. There is, as I referred at the start, just some internal learning, I think, for us to do, you know, picking up these new processes, how we ask better questions of those health professionals, how we find the right health professional as well, who may be in contact with a client. So we said in the very early days of this that we shouldn't be relying on GPs. I think, yeah. Our early sort of reflection is we probably still relied a little bit too much on GPs to go to for information. Mm. And actually, you know, they aren't always the best people to do this. They may not be, you know, in direct contact with the clients on a daily basis. So finding those healthcare professionals who are able to do that is probably easier. As outlined as well, we're also using our health and social care practitioners far more. Mm. So when we launched adult disability, as you'll be aware, one of the fundamental changes we made from the UK system was to bring those health and social care practitioners into the organisation. Mm-hmm. So we have colleagues sitting in the organisation with a vast wealth and knowledge and expertise around about all of these conditions that our clients may have. So one of those improvement actions that we've taken is to make sure that if we're struggling to get supporting evidence, actually, is there enough in the application? where it doesn't lead to necessarily a client having a consultation as such, but a case discussion might help the decision maker just understand the condition and the impact around about it. So I don't know, Ali might want to say a little bit about how we're working with that set of stakeholders in particular, but we'll continue to work with health boards trying to get the information that we know we've got. We're also trying to make there's a portal in place for GPs in particular to help provide information. So we're working with GPs, surgeries to make sure that that's active as well. And you'll be aware that we've recently introduced an ability to pay for third sector providers to give us this information as well, which is a relatively recent addition that we've put in place to make sure that isn't a barrier as well. But I don't know, Ali, if there's anything else you want to
say. Just a couple of things. I was going to mention the fee to third sector organisations, which I think is helpful. We have an operational reference group where we engage on a six-weekly basis with third sector organisations, where we provide information around what we're doing operationally so they can understand what it is we're doing, how we're doing it, and some of the challenges and learning that we're facing. But it's about engagement, that forum. So just to the point that was made by SCOS, I think it is that feedback loop in terms of what it is that we're experiencing and some of the challenges in relation to processing cases, and also how they can support us in doing that in a timely fashion. That's happening, that has been happening, and the engagement with stakeholders and that stakeholder community has been fairly constructive in that area in relation to them recognising actually that they can help us in that space to do that information gather quicker and to reach more speedy decisions. And over the course of the summer, we're looking to roll out a further engagement plan again with that stakeholder community, where we kind of set out what it is that we're trying to do and how they can help us in doing that. And again, conversations have been ongoing, but we're looking to try and build on that, and David probably will lead some of those conversations with some of the senior representatives of stakeholders so they're exactly understanding what it is that we're looking to do.
So we've touched upon processing times already this morning, and what I was wondering was, once you get that supporting information and it's complete, what's the delay between having the information and actually making a decision about an individual's case? How long is that period of time on average?
We probably don't measure that particular metrics to hand, so we could certainly take away and see, but I don't think we probably have that direct measure in place. I'm looking to Ali, who might tell me differently.
No, so we don't have that measure. We don't. I mean, I think what I would say, if what you're referring to is any potential blockers once we have the information, I would suggest not, but again, we can provide more information on that. But what I would say is we've spent some time with our case managers understanding what it is that they do with that supporting information, how they do the case conference piece with our health and social care professional colleagues. And I think that that's part of improvement action that we're taking. But what I would say is there has been a real kind of want through kind of the values of the organisation to get to the right outcome for the client. So perhaps there has been there's been something in the mind of our staff around about continually seeking for that extra piece of information which may or may not exist. And I think it's about building the capability and confidence within our staff to understand that they have the information, they're able to understand the impact of the information on the client to make a decision at a point which is helpful. I think the organisation is still learning, and I think to your point around blockers, I would suggest not, but perhaps there is something about our confidence and how we use the evidence that we have.
Is there ongoing IT problems?
In relation to making
processing cases?
No.
What about duplicate profiles?
There will be some duplicate profiles in the case. So, just for newer members in particular, I might bring Sue into this point as well. The programme of delivery, which I outlined at the start, is one of the biggest sort of technology programmes the Scottish Government has. We're delivering it, as I think you're aware, in an agile way. Mm-hmm. So, what that means is we deliver enough technology to deliver the benefit, and then that allows us to continue to go on and deliver more benefits. And throughout that process as well, additional functionality comes into the system. So the consequence of agile, and it's a feature of the delivery rather than an error, as it were, in the system, is that when we launch a benefit, we do not have the complete technology in front of us. So if that's perceived as an issue, that's a consequence of the way that we're delivering.
But it's an issue for the individual who can't get a decision because there's a duplicate profile, there is an IT fix that needs to be done to merge those two profiles so that a decision maker can make a decision, but they can't make a decision until the two profiles are merged. The information we've had on a particular case that's thankfully now been resolved but took 5 months was that it was an IT issue.
I'm happy to look at that. I mean, duplicate profiles aren't something that comes to me as a common issue. I mean, clearly in the case of your constituent, that's unacceptable and has my apologies for that. Happy to take that away. But certainly duplicate profiles don't come to me as one of the major things that needs to be corrected in the system. So I'm happy to take that particular instance away and have a look at it. Okay. I might just ask Sue if that's something that's crossed Sue's radar.
It's not something that has come to any of the work that I've been doing around this.
Yeah. But these things will exist in all systems. Again, that's too long to rectify that problem, but all systems will potentially have duplicates in it that we need to make sure that we eradicate, make sure the data is correct in it. So that's not one I'd heard about, but I'm happy to take it away. But the wider point around about agile delivery, I think, is a really important element of how we're delivering. Audit Scotland, as you're aware, have reported on the progress of the programme at various points and have kind of highlighted the agile delivery as the right mechanism for us to be using. But it does mean at various stages we're operating on what we would term as a minimum viable product.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to bring in James and then Katie. Thank you. And James is joining us online. So.
Morning. Thank you, convener. I'd like to discuss the consultations. Understand why there was a expectation that consultations won't be the norm, given people's bad experiences with PIP. But given that the consultations that have taken place under ADP have been generally very well received, can you tell me, are staff spending a lot of time trying to make a decision without a consultation, when a consultation sometimes may be very much what is needed?
What I think I would say is I don't think staff are trying to deliberately avoid putting a case to a consultation. As Ali said a little bit there, I think our staff are absolutely focused on trying to get what's best for the client, including if that potentially is added to some delays in the system. So the example I would give of that, and Sue, Ali and I all sat with some of our decision makers looking at this. So even in an example where we might think there's enough information to make a decision, if the decision maker actually thinks a higher level award might be merited, we have gone in that case out to try and get additional information to support a higher level of award. So it's not simply saying, we don't think there's enough information to make a decision in a case. The organisation and the people in it have been committed to try and get the best possible right outcome for the client. So I think the sort of when we brought our health and social care practitioners into the organisation, and made the sort of trying to sort of switch the 80-20. So in the UK system, around about 80% of people having assessment, trying to sort of put that round. That was about, we thought the evidence would be there in those 80% of cases to make a decision, not that there was a target that we shouldn't use consultations. So as part of the improvement, we are definitely looking at other cases where we could more quickly come to a decision if we put through to a consultation. And I think you were highlighting as well, actually the feedback from clients who have gone through that process is on the whole overwhelmingly positive. So, for them it feels very different than going through the assessment, which is good because it was entirely designed to be different from that. So we're not scared, as it were, to put people through if that's the right thing to do. I think it comes back to the wider, our teams just need to find that right balance about information, getting it right for the client, and then pulling it to a quick conclusion.
All the reports are very complimentary on the way consultations have been dealt with, but given that, is there any danger that sort of trying to speed up the process, and I completely understand why you want to speed up the process, that's, everybody wants that, is this going to jeopardise any of the potential outcomes, or have you got safeguards in place to make sure that that is not going to, or is not likely to happen?
I would like to say that we've got safeguards in place to do that. I mean, we have fundamentally changed what a consultation looks like. The guidance that our health and social care practitioners have when they're completing a consultation means that, you know, doing more of them isn't suddenly going to sort of revert to something that happened under a UK system. That's not going to happen. It may put a bottleneck in a different place, and we're really, really mindful and careful that all of the improvement actions aren't just sort of pushing on a bit of a bottleneck somewhere else into the system. So making sure we've got the capacity to do more consultations if we do them will be really important, but we will not jeopardise what it feels like to undergo a consultation, because as you'll be aware, you know, making that feel different to our clients was fundamentally one of the 2016 consultation responses. So when we looked at what makes this system different, fundamentally that was part of it. There are other elements as too that we could come on and talk about, local delivery in particular, support up front, but we will not jeopardise what it feels like to go through a consultation with the organisation.
Yeah, there's certainly nothing but good words being said about it. So I'll just leave it like that then, convener. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks, James. I'm now going to hand over to Katie and then Paul, who's joining us online also. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm wanting to ask about the extent to which we're currently still in a settling in period. And in your submission, you said it was always expected that processing times would need a settling in period whilst staff gain experience and new systems are introduced. And you've said already that usually it might take a member of staff up to a year to really get across the whole role. Now, the child disability payment has been available nationally since November 2021. One, but there doesn't seem to be any indication that processing times are going down. So would you consider that we're still in the settling in period in relation to that specific benefit?
I think we're still overall in a period which is settling. So just to focus on child disability, one of the things that when we went swiftly into adult disability was that some of the expertise that had helped us launch child was then moved across to go into adult as well. So whilst that on paper looks like something that's been more stable for longer, that isn't necessarily the case as well. I think I would also come back to when I made my opening statement just about the layering up of benefit upon benefit. So over that Christmas period, clearly we're launching a benefit which then doesn't fully embed in before we then launch an X benefit, and that puts extraordinary pressure on people, so the guidance changes. And some of it is back to the question around agile delivery as well. So even though child disability payment may have looked stable, we were still making changes to a system that would have affected our decision makers and our client advisors who were dealing with that system as well. So we do not launch a benefit on a single platform, call it stable, call it complete, and leave it. The organisation is effectively through a consistent period of change, and that can be challenging for us for our staff working on that. So I take the point. You know, we've had a year longer than that, and on paper that should mean that we're in a better place in terms of processing.
Could you give an indication of when you think the processing times might start to come down in relation to that specific benefit, child disability?
So we are seeing internally good progress in terms of this now. So the things which give us confidence internally around about this is we're seeing the productivity of our people really starting to increase now. So that driving how many decisions we've made. We see over the last couple of weeks now we're making far more decisions inside the organisation than we have ever made before. So our record couple of weeks in terms of numbers of decisions have all happened in the last couple of weeks. And the more we can do that, the more that we sort of cut through the head of work. We are in a position where we're hoping by the end of the summer we would bring that average time under the 80 mark, and then as a stepping stone we'll continue to work on those processing times.
Thank you. And will you keep the committee advised in terms of progress on that issue? But also if there are specific problems, if you could proactively share that with us, that would be
absolutely
very helpful. You'll have seen that there's been a lot of publicity round about personal independence payment and the fact that those decisions are currently being made more quickly than the adult disability payment. Over time, do you expect that gap to narrow, or do you think there are elements of adult disability payment decision-making process that mean it's likely to offer being a longer process than personal independence payment?
So I'm probably not going to try and focus on the gap, because the gap could narrow because PIP increased, which is clearly what nobody wants as well. So I'm probably more focused on bringing our processing times down for our clients rather than the particular gap with DWP. You're right, there are some things that are fundamentally different in the system as well. You know, information gathering that we've talked about. So the systems aren't always completely comparable, but I think the main thing for our clients is bringing down our processing times rather than measuring it as a gap with DWP. I have to say there is a point in time. I mean, DWP have done an extraordinarily good job of bringing their processing times just now down as well. And if you look back historically, clearly that's not always been the case. And I refer to, you know, benefit launches. If you look at the sort of the profile of processing times when PIP launched as a new benefit, I think they went up to around about 35 weeks before bringing that back down. So we're falling a bit of a profile lower down, but a similar profile to that benefit launch. So I don't see it as a competition or DWP as a comparator for our clients. It's getting that processing time down.
Yeah, I don't see it as a comparison either, but you know, claimants have said to me that their experiences of Social Security Scotland are worse than they had with the DWP, and they've also said they didn't believe that was going to be possible. So would you agree that we need to make sure that we have the highest standards in the quickest processing times, and the expectation is that it would be better than the DWP, and I'm very much welcome if they're getting better at their processes. So, you know, how quickly can we expect better processing times in relation to adult disability payment, would you say?
So, again, I think by the end of the summer, we should be starting to see that. There will be a bit of a lag in our published stats, but I'm happy to come back to the committee and keep
that would be very much appreciated if you could keep us closely advised. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Paul.
Thank you very much, convener. I wonder if I can just ask about how processing times are actually impacting clients. What's the view about the impact that that's having, and how does Social Security Scotland keep people informed and updated throughout their process whilst they are waiting? You know, is there a regular communication? Are there set points in the process where communication is proactive?
So again, I just reiterate from the start, Mr. O'Kane, you know, everybody in the organisation is completely committed for our clients. And as I was describing some of the other answers, part of, I think, some of those increasing times have been because we have been absolutely trying to get the best from our clients. When we think about processing times, nobody should be in that cycle where they haven't had communication from the agency. And we've been trying to do some things there which are also by telephony as well. So, you know, it is not unusual in the current under our system to be just phoning a client and, you know, asking about the supporting evidence, you know, saying where we are with it. We would like to get much smarter that in terms of use of technology, and that's some of the stuff that Sue was referring to in the previous answers. Nobody is waiting what we would see as those average processing times before they hear from the organisation. And indeed, you know, we would expect multiple times in there. Also in those, and some of those applications will be applications where we have simply lost contact with the client as well, so they will be pushing up some of those averages, where again, as an organisation, I think we need to become a little bit clearer about how we close off cases where we're not, where we've effectively lost contact for whatever reason with a client, we can't communicate with them. So again, Sue might want to say something more about how we improve that, including whether we can look at text messages, for example. I think when I was here back in December, I think Mr. Balfour asked a question around about, you know, direct portal with a client, and, you know, would it be helpful if they could dial in and see the progress of their application? And I think at the time I said something of yes, that of course that would be helpful for clients. So we continue to look at these things as well. But I'll maybe just ask Sue to come back to that automated contact with clients.
Yeah, I suppose it's about automation and about personalisation as well. It's not just about sending a you know, generic text, although we will be updating people with text messages. But again, we're looking at ways in which we can have those touch points throughout, and again, doing that proactive step at the front step. You know, it's good to have that interaction with a person, people calling you, telling you where the you know, we've received your application. So again, that has been received very well by clients as well. But we're also looking at that, as I mentioned earlier, that end-to-end journey, and seeing what automation we can put into that end-to-end journey. It's not something, it's not simple, but again, it's something that we're looking at proactively as a sort of improvement overall for the client journey as we go through that process.
Thank you. I wonder if I can just expand on the point about the telephone system and people calling in for advice. You know, I've seen data that 1 in 5 calls are left on hold for over half an hour, and 28,000 calls were waiting for over an hour. And indeed, the longest call waiting time, I think, recorded is 3 hours, 7 minutes and 25 seconds. So obviously, there's a particular issue in terms of, I don't know if it's call volume or not having a system in place that's robust enough in terms of some of those issues. I wonder if you can maybe just say something about the action that's been taken to rectify some of those issues.
Yeah, certainly. So I'm conscious those numbers are unacceptable, and I think that probably relates to our last published statistics that we've put out. One of the things we've done internally is far more active engagement on moving resource directly onto the lines. So what we now do, rather than try to sort of have a fixed resource based on what we think the volume coming in is, we've got performance managers inside the organisation actively managing every individual queue inside the agency, moving resource as it's required to do that. So I think already that we're seeing those numbers come down quite significantly. I'll maybe bring Ali in as well, because the stakeholder forum, which Ali referred to earlier, we've been asking those questions of, are people starting to see those improvements on the ground? And we believe that the answer to that is yes. But Ali, I don't know if you just wanted to reflect on that point.
Yes, so there's probably a couple of things there. So I think we absolutely recognise that the numbers you quoted there aren't acceptable, and we have put measures in place to seek improvement. So there are a few things that we've done. So I hope we're being a bit smarter around about the management of queues, so trying to direct our clients to the right queue so they get to speak to the right individual about their case more quickly. And we are seeing an impact on that, and we are seeing the benefit of that, and we're hearing that through the stakeholder community as well. And I think also, to your point around about technology, we have spoken to our supplier about how we can best, you know, use the technology that we have available to us, and we're starting to see some benefits that we can implement through that, through, you know, various different activities that we can take forward through management information, etc. We've also had conversations with other suppliers in the sector, including NHS 24, around about what it is they do and what they do well and what we can learn from that. So, you know, as you would expect, we are looking at process, and we're looking at process with a view to improve things. And I think, you know, as David has said, we are hopefully, anecdotally, starting to see feedback which suggests that a difference has been made in that area.
And I don't know, Sue, if you want to just pick up that point. As I said in my own statement, we are looking end-to-end every place where our clients interact with the organisation. And if there's any improvements that we can do in that, we'll absolutely include technology in that review as well, Sue.
Indeed, yeah. And that's the you know, that end-to-end review, as we've mentioned, as we review each step in the process, we'll look at where we can bring improvements into that and when we can do that. So again, it's not about looking at that, you know, we are looking at that sort of, you know, short, medium and long term. What can we do immediately, and what can we do and what can we plan for the future as well? So that is very much a joint activity with the agency and the programme and Scottish Government. So again, that prioritisation, how do we do that, is something that is at the heart of what we're trying to do as we take these improvements and these opportunities to improve that journey for our clients.
Thank you. If I may, Convener, David, you mentioned there that you expect to see call wait times come down. I mean, are you able to say in terms of, do you have a timescale in terms of what you're working towards in bringing those numbers down? And are you taking an approach where you're looking at targets around that? You know, so we'll be able to analyse, you know, what improvement looks like, essentially.
So these are actions that we're taking now. So internally, what we see is calls now on average below 20-minute marker. We will continue to sort of monitor and try and drive that down as well. Again, it will take a little bit of time for those numbers to be reflected in the published statistics, but the work that I was describing about the active queue management has helped drive those times down. So this isn't something which I'm saying we will look at. This is something that we're fundamentally doing now to try and make that telephone experience far better for clients phoning the organisation. So absolutely, those are numbers that we will see, and we will see coming through the published stats. But internally, we are seeing now, and as Ali was referring to, when we speak to our stakeholders, they tell us that they're seeing that improvement as well.
Similar to Katie Clark's point, I think it would be useful if committee could be updated on the progress there, if there's a willingness to do that.
I'm happy to.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thanks very much, Paul. I'm now going to bring in Marie, and then after that, it will come to an end unless there's any other member get any other questions. So, Marie, thanks.
Thank you, convener. It's good to see you all along at the committee this morning. Understandably, the session is obviously focused on processing times. I found your written submission very helpful. Social Security Scotland and DWP have different approaches, and to illustrate this, in section 12 of your submission, you state both CDP and ADP improve significantly the DWP benefits they replace. To give some context with what we're dealing with, can you expand on what you mean by that?
So I think when we spoke about child and adult in particular, I would always highlight three significant changes that were made in terms of the process. And the first was the application process itself. So huge amount of effort was invested working with clients to get that online application in particular into a place which people could readily and easily use. And you know, we've done some sessions trying to sort of illustrate to MSPs and constituency staff what that actually looks like front end. But for example, the use of photography in there was, we think, quite groundbreaking in a disability application form. We thought some of the prompts in there, again, that was reminding clients, you know, some things that you may have normalised in your life actually will help you qualify for a benefit. So think about these things as well. So the application process absolutely up front was one of the key changes that we made. And we have around, for disability benefits, we've got around about 70% of clients which now use that channel. I think what we also were really clear for all benefits, that all channels are available as well. So that suits for people who are digitally able to do that or supported to do that. But we are also available through telephony. You know, so if people want to make an application on the phone, we will help them do that. On face-to-face as well. So the second big change I always talk about is local delivery function. So we now have people based everywhere in Scotland helping people with applications. So the premise and the rationale of that was you should not have to go to a third party to negotiate applying for a benefit. If you want to apply for a benefit, we will help you do that. So some of the work of our local delivery teams, and I know they're in every area. I'm happy to recirculate a list of contacts. You know, some members I know have been meeting with our local delivery reps, and that's something we'd absolutely encourage to happen as well. So in those instances, we've got people, if they need support with a disability benefit, they can go into people's houses. You know, so we have examples of, again, anecdotally, but you know, what we hear back is people who would not have applied for a benefit you know, are now applying for benefits. And you know, when we speak to our local delivery teams, they will say they're building up some of their old relationships. They might be in a library every Tuesday for a month or so before somebody actually comes across and tells them that they need help and support destigmatising applying for benefits. So that's the second fundamental thing I would say. And as has been touched on before, moving those health and social care practitioners in, both what a consultation feels like, but bringing that into the organisation is something that we would always say was the three major changes that we'd made to the system, which were all driven from clients' experience, and which then leads us to say we believe there's improvements because this is what our clients asked for way back to that 2016 consultation.
Thanks. Making the process much more accessible. There have been comparisons made with processing time for PIP and ADP. Given the process of making decisions is very different, do you think these comparisons are of much value to us?
So I go back a bit, I think, to my answer to Ms Clark as well. I think it's inevitable people will make the comparisons, but I don't think they're hugely helpful, but it's difficult to say that against a time which is clearly unacceptable. So I think, again, just to be utterly clear, we want to bring these numbers down. But the systems are different. People at particularly that front end of the system, as I said earlier, you know, our teams are absolutely focused on trying to get people the right benefit and the right level of benefit, and inevitably I think that has added to some of those early processing times as well. So I think the comparison will be inevitable, but I think you're right. I would always just be cautious. For me, it's about making sure it works for the client. And what I would say on that, and I should have said in response to Ms Clark's question as well, the thing that we usually focus on there is the customer charter, and again, this isn't a charter that we came up with. It was driven by clients and people in Scotland about what they wanted to see. And yes, timeliness is a measure in there, but I think it's one of 50, 60 measures in there which are measuring the overall what it feels like to engage in the organisation. And the one which I keep coming back to, and I think I've probably quoted before, is we ask clients just, were you treated with kindness? Now, as a public organisation, processing an application, that was, I think, quite a novel and quite an innovative measure to put in place. And the last 2 years, it's come back that 94% of people said, yes, they were treated with kindness. So it's, I think, inevitably just now we're going to be compared with those DWP times. Over time, I would like to get back to the chart and say, actually, it's our measure, but here's the other things that people told us really mattered to them.
Thank you. The number of redeterminations are low. What more can be done to promote the claimant's right to a redetermination?
So again, I think there's probably something about direct notification. There's certainly something about working with stakeholders around about just being clear. So we do work with the advice sector. We'll continue to make that point as well. I don't think I put it in the submission as well, but also the availability of voiceability. Mm-hmm. So the Scottish Government, separate to the organisation for obvious reasons, have funded and supported voiceability for people claiming disability benefits as an advocacy service as well. So we're working closely with voiceability about referrals, but we're also working closely with the advice sector just to make sure that that's understood. And again, there are changes to that process about how we operate that. One of the first things a client asking for a redetermination will get is a call from the organisation trying to say, well, do you have any more evidence? Is there anything else that we could do to support a redetermination? So again, I think we've made that process far, far easier to navigate and putting a bit more onus on us as an organisation to make that process work.
Thanks. And my last point, equally, can appeals are low, so what can be done to promote the right to appeal?
So it will be similar in terms of redeterminations. I would just be cautious that I think we're back to the point of being saying, you know, how new is a new benefit. I think we're probably at that stage of appeals. It's a handful at the moment because of effectively the lag of the system. I think we will see those coming up as more and more cases flow through the system. So again, I wouldn't at the moment say that as a settled level of appeals in the system. I think we've yet to say that. But in terms of heightening awareness of it, it will be the same activity that we'll undertake with our stakeholders, with voiceability to make sure that that's understood, that it's an option.
Thanks for that. Thanks, Katie.
Okay, thanks, Minnie. I'm just going to quickly bring in Katie.
Yeah, I'm just a little bit concerned by what you're saying and whether there's an appreciation within the agency of how important it is for people to get money quickly. And I very much welcome what you're saying if the evidence is that claimants are finding that the agency is treating them with more kindness and with more respect. And if that is the case, that is something that is a massive advance in where we've been in the past. But as you know, the reality is the reason that most people are claiming these benefits is because they're in financial difficulties, some of them extreme financial difficulties where they can't heat and they can't eat. So can you just reassure the committee that you do have an understanding of the client group that you're dealing with and of the importance of ensuring that cases are processed quickly and that people receive money quickly for the reasons given?
Absolutely. absolutely. If I've given that impression, I absolutely did not mean to give that impression. I think what I was saying or trying to say was that against this background, of course, processing times is the absolute focus of the organisation.
Yes, thank you.
But as we move into, and the charter will be reviewed or would be due to be reviewed next year, I think the whole package of measures is something that really does matter. But against the current processing times, absolutely, it is the single focus of the organisation to bring down.
Helpful.
And I wouldn't want to leave you with any other impression.
Thank you. That's helpful to have on record. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Katie. Okay, so that actually brings us to the end of our questions today. So I'd like to thank the officials for joining us today and also look forward to visiting in September when we come through to Dundee. So that concludes our public business. We will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you, everyone.